Good afternoon. Gentlemen, feel free, because I do. It is my pleasure to have you here today, looking beautiful, sweating it out, having successfully managed more or less your first weekend here. Eagerly awaiting, is that the for the more or the less? I don't know, what was that? Heard that little shout out. Eagerly awaiting the start of classes tomorrow. As I did at the second freshman assembly, I want to recognize the transfer students who are in attendance. Welcome. I also want to welcome those students who are joining us for the year through the Visiting International Student Program, as well as those students, they're in the house, as well as those students who are returning to college through the Eli Whitney Scholars Program. I am so happy you're all here today. As the majority of you can attest, the opening days of college are filled with an overwhelming amount of information, acronyms, appointments, and endless advice that runs along the lines of do this, do that, but really don't do this, and definitely don't do that. At some point, all this newness runs the risk of turning into noise that you're unable to process. I recognize that this event, coming near the end of your fifth day on campus and data overload, could be seen as one more information session. I want you to think of it in a different way, however. At freshman keynote address, we invite a senior member of our faculty to speak to the first year students on a topic of their choice. There is a twist here, however. The faculty we invite to speak were just like you in college. I mean this more literally than you can imagine. The faculty we invite graduated from Yale College. Who better to offer you your first lecture at Yale than someone who knows at an organic level what it was like to sit here, sit where you are sitting, to walk the same path to class that you will walk tomorrow? With all of this in mind, it is my pleasure to introduce you to Beverly Gage, Professor of History, Director of Undergraduate Studies in History, and the inaugural chair of our inaugural Faculty Senate. Professor Gage is a historian of 20th century American politics and society. She teaches courses on modern American political history, liberalism and conservatism, communism and anti-communism, and the craft of historical writing. She is currently writing a major new biography of former FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover, titled G-Man, J. Edgar Hoover and the American Century. Her first book, The Day Wall Street Exploded, explored the dramatic story of the 1920 bombing of Wall Street and the history of early 20th century terrorism. It is currently in production as a documentary film for broadcast on the American Experience in late 2015. Professor Gage writes widely for publications including the New York Times, Washington Post, The Nation, and Slate. She has published scholarly articles and reviews in the Journal of American History, the American Historical Review, the Journal of Policy History, Reviews in American History, and so forth. She appears frequently on the PBS NewsHour, among other outlets, as a historical and political commentator. Last year, Professor Gage discovered what one scholar referred to as something of an American history holy grail. She was working in the National Archives, conducting research for her current book, when she discovered the first fully unredacted copy of a letter from the FBI to Martin Luther King Jr. in 1964. This letter, famously referred to as the suicide letter, because the author, the FBI, tried to convince King to kill himself, this letter had never been seen in its entirety. Beyond being a critical piece of evidence that sheds light on how the more paranoid niches in the federal government viewed the civil rights leader, this letter is a reminder of why we come to a place like Yale. We come here to be part of a community of thinkers who are never satisfied with the stories that we inherit, thinkers who have an appetite to find out more, to seek out why, and critically, to explain what they have found and its importance. Professor Gage is just that kind of thinker and scholar. She also happens to be one of our most celebrated educators, receiving the Sarai Ribicoff Award for Teaching Excellence in Yale College in 2009. Most seriously, though, she happens to be the mother of a very kind son who happens to have as one of his best friends my very kind son. And together they enjoy playing Minecraft, playing Super Smash Bros., and a multitude of other games I simply can't master. Ladies and gentlemen, a member of the Yale class of 1994, an American studies major who graduated magna cum laude and with distinction, and now an award-winning historian who discovers holy grails, Beverly Gage.
Well, thank you, Jonathan, and thanks to all of you for being here for yet one more event in this heat. Thanks to all of you, the class of 2019. Woo! Cheer for yourselves. I should make one note to what Jonathan was saying about the Martin Luther King letter that I discovered and wrote about over the summer, that I was actually not the person who found the document, that it was actually my undergraduate research assistant, who happens to be sitting here right now, Jacob Wasserman, who was sitting there in the National Archives taking photographs for me. So. Now, admittedly, Jacob didn't know what he was looking at, but nonetheless, he did take the photograph of the document. So I realized in preparing this talk that 2015 marks the 25th anniversary of my own start at Yale as a freshman. I came to Yale in 1990, so this was back in the dark ages when there was a smoking section inside the library, and B, nobody had an email account. Realizing that 25 years have passed since that moment, of course, makes me feel a little bit old, and I realize now, looking around, that I am one of the few people in the room who was even born in 1990. But it also makes me want to reach back in time to my 18-year-old self and assure her that things were going to turn out okay. Because that's not at all how I felt when I was sitting here in Woolsey Hall 25 years ago about to start my first classes at Yale, and that may or may not be how all of you feel sitting here today. And some of the connections between then and now, or to put it another way, between there and here, are what I'm going to talk about today. When I arrived on the Yale campus 25 years ago, I immediately suspected that I was not going to be a very good Yale student. I was a good student in the sense that you are all presumably good students. I got good grades in high school, and I knew how to work hard when I had to, though I did not always necessarily work as hard as I could. And that was part of being a good student, too. But I was not sure that I would turn out to be a very good Yale student. And so let me explain a little bit about why that was. From my first moment on campus, I found myself confronted with what I've come to think of as the three somewhat contradictory messages that Yale delivers to arriving freshmen. The first was a message of praise. You alone, among thousands of talented, wonderful, brilliant people who applied to Yale, have been selected for admission. And this means that each one of you is very, very special. The second, which you are, the second was a message of pressure. You are now surrounded by thousands of talented, wonderful, brilliant people, and you had better step it up because this isn't high school anymore and you're not going to be the best one. The third, and I think maybe the most difficult for me, was a message of privilege. As the talented, brilliant, wonderful person you are, you have been granted entry into one of the world's wealthiest and most exclusive clubs, a place that will give you access to global leaders and titans of industry and famous artists and writers and thinkers, all because you are now one of us. Frankly, I did not know what to think about all of this, and I came away from my first days at Yale with a lot of conflicting thoughts and emotions. I was excited to be here, thrilled about the opportunity that had been handed to me, and eager to meet my classmates and my professors. At the same time, I was nervous about the future, afraid that I would not live up to expectations, and wondering if maybe Yale had a big blind spot when it came to its own wealth and influence and privilege. So I did what I think many freshmen do. Instead of plunging into campus life and trying new things, I started out doing exactly what I knew I was good at, and I started out only doing those things where I knew I could excel. In my case, that was classical music. I had played the piano and the violin fairly seriously in high school, and I had done some conducting and some singing. And so I started my life at Yale by signing up for piano lessons and taking music theory and joining chamber music performance, and that was that. But something curious happened over the course of my freshman year here. Despite all of my conflicted feelings, despite all of my worries, I began to learn from the people I encountered and from the ideas that I was finding in class. I learned, first of all, that there was not just one Yale, that Yale was many different things to many different people, and that this was actually the whole point. There were lots of people on campus, including, I should mention, the dean of the college and the president of the university, as you saw on Saturday, who had their own views about Yale's strengths and weaknesses, but who nonetheless loved being here and sought to make Yale the best place that it could be. I also learned that I was fascinated by history and literature, and that despite my music-centered schedule, those were the things that really got me excited. And so at the end of my freshman year, I gave my first ever, and still only, solo piano recital in the J.E. Dining Hall. J.E., you're out there? Okay. And then I quit taking music lessons for the rest of my life. I came back as a sophomore American Studies major and began pursuing the ideas and subjects that still define what I do today. So that was my freshman year. I acknowledge on one level that this is not a very dramatic story. It can actually be summed up in three words. I switched majors. But it didn't feel nearly so simple at the time as I was trying to make these decisions about my own life and to sort out the difference between what other people expected of me and what I wanted for myself. It was a time when I often felt lonely and confused and unsure about what I should do next, but it was also exciting, and more than that, it was entirely necessary. A chance to break out of old molds and try something new. And this is the message that I want you to take away from these first few days on campus. Yale is above all an opportunity to grow and learn and change and to think seriously about who you are and what you want. Freshman year is the time that you get to start writing the story of your own life. So now let's fast forward 25 years. I've been back here at Yale teaching as a professor of American history for more than a decade. And in that role, I spend a lot of time talking with students about what I often describe as the paradoxes of history, but about the blend of change and continuity that makes up the human past. Dean Holloway and President Salovey talked about these themes on Saturday in the context of Yale and its relationship with slavery and white supremacy. Today, I would like to encourage you to think about those questions not as they apply to Yale, but as they apply to your own lives. As a professor here, I teach a course on the history of liberalism and conservatism in the United States. And we look in that class about how those two terms change over time and in some ways stay the same. And as part of that class, I ask students to write their political autobiographies, to think about why they hold the political views that they do, and to imagine what larger forces in society might have led them to this place. This is something we often do when we're thinking about historical figures. What part is John Calhoun the man, and what part was simply the times in which he lived, the region in which he was born, his race or religion or class or the political views of his own family? So I ask students to turn that lens on themselves and to think about forces outside of their own individual ambition or temperament or intellect that may have shaped how they think about the world. And they end up writing about all sorts of things. Some students write about conversations around the dinner table, about their mother who made them listen to NPR, or their father who made them watch Fox News. Others write about their direct experiences, say the difficulties and rewards of being the only out gay student in a conservative high school, or of being the quote-unquote scholarship kid in a world of wealth. Sometimes, since this is Yale, students write about hanging out with their parents in the White House and watching politics unfold from the top down. Others write about their grassroots experiences, the thrills and disappointments of working on a political campaign or throwing their energies into a movement for social transformation. So a lot of these papers draw on early experiences, elements of childhood, or even deeper back into family history. But one of the things that has struck me most of all in reading these papers has been how much students change during their time at Yale. Just for the record, I don't mean that they all become raging liberals, which is what many people in the outside world would think actually happens inside of Yale. I mean that they, and now you, change in all sorts of different ways and find a vast range of new experiences. In the next 4 years, some of you may run for local political office or student government. Many of you will probably vote for the first time. Hopefully, all of you will meet someone who fundamentally challenges your assumptions and either persuades you to their cause or shows you how to respectfully disagree. Some of you may discover new aspects of your sexuality or new extracurricular interests, and some of you may read a book or take a class that significantly changes your point of view. Whatever those experiences may be, the key is that they will happen here, that Yale changes and broadens and transforms the people within its community. Your job is to take all of this in and then discard some of it, those parts that aren't useful or that don't speak to you in meaningful ways. Think of it as an editing process. This year, you get to write a first draft of your own Yale experience, and then you have 3 more years to fine-tune what you want to do and what you want to say. And at the end of it all, you will hopefully have a remarkable story of your own to tell. All right, the other thing that professors do at Yale besides teaching is that we conduct our own research. Well, we actually also attend faculty meetings and serve on committees, but since it's so hot in here, I will not go into elaborate descriptions of all of that. At the moment, as Dean Holloway mentioned, my own research project is a really big, fat doorstop biography of J. Edgar Hoover, who was the director of the FBI from 1924 to 1972, so a big chunk of the 20th century, 48 years. Often when I tell people that I am writing a biography of Hoover, they say, "Oh, why would you want to spend so much time with such an awful man?" For those of you who aren't familiar with Hoover's reputation, he's widely known as a kind of tyrannical figure in Washington, so someone who was spying on everyone and then using all of that information to kind of cement his own political power, which is how he lasted 48 years in office. Part of my task as a biographer is to attempt to humanize this man and to make him into more than just a one-dimensional villain. One of the ways that I've tried to do this is to take another look at his childhood and especially his college years and to think about how those early experiences shaped the person he became. For instance, he was born and bred in Washington, D.C., in a little house that was just 5 blocks from the Capitol, so he grew up in a culture of government service. His father was mentally ill with what we would today describe as something like severe depression, so Hoover never had the chance to go away to college, and he attended night school at home in Washington so that he could stay nearby and earn money and take care of his parents. During college, he joined a fraternity called Kappa Alpha, which was a Southern fraternity founded explicitly to carry on traditions of white supremacy and to promote the values of the antebellum slaveholding South. So this was early training in a kind of racialized thinking that would ultimately have very serious consequences for the entire nation. And then he happened to graduate from college in 1917, at the very moment that the United States was entering World War I. And so he stepped into a government job because he was a boy in Washington and the bureaucracy was expanding. And as it turned out, he never left. He went to work at the Justice Department at the age of 22, became head of the FBI at 29, and died in that same job at the age of 77. I tell this story not to suggest that the first job you take out of college will be the job that you will have to hold for the rest of your life. Instead, I want to emphasize that we are, all of us, even supposed one-dimensional tyrants like Hoover, at once the products of the world into which we are born, or the organizations we join in college, and our own individual ambitions and desires and will. There are already many factors that have combined to put each of you on your current path in life, and there will be many other factors, often beyond your control, that shape where you end up. Right now, at this plastic moment in time, the day before your first college classes, this is a moment to sit back and reflect about what you want and how you want to shape your own path into the future. Okay, so now, as I finish up, I also want to offer a few words of practical advice. I know you've been getting a lot of this in recent days, particularly before you plunge into the strange and wonderful experience known as Yale shopping period. All right. Point one, don't go crazy. There are more than 1,000 classes being offered this semester at Yale, and the purpose of shopping period is not to shop them all. Shopping period is really great to try out classes where you think you might be interested. It's a wonderful opportunity to experiment, but it can sometimes make people a little crazy if they're running from class to class to class. So be selective about what you do in the next few days. Leave room in your schedule for something that you're doing just because you want to do it. But don't go around to every single class, because the truth of the matter is that you actually can't know what you're going to get out of class until you've invested something of yourself in it. And that process doesn't really begin until shopping period is over. Point two. Be selfish. On Saturday, Dean Holloway asked you to thank your parents and your teachers and the people from your hometown for all they've done for you, all of which is wonderful, but now they are gone, and I can offer a different piece of advice, which is to forget about them. Don't really do that entirely, but make the choices that you ultimately want to make here on campus, because you are the only one who is living here, and you are the only one who is experiencing your own life. Number three, ask for help. There's a lot you still don't know, despite this week of activity, about how Yale works, and that is how it should be. Even if it seems like everyone around you already knows everything, I can tell you with 100% certainty that they are faking it. So don't be afraid to ask even basic information. And for instance, it took me a long time as a freshman to figure out that professors really want you to go to their office hours, that they hold office hours so you can stop by, they can get to know you, and you can have a real intellectual and personal exchange. I have one other little piece of gathering information advice, and I'm going to abuse my place up here on the platform, and Dean Holloway can't object because he is also a historian in the history department. Tomorrow night in the history department, we are holding a shopping party for all undergraduates who are interested in history to come get to know us, learn about our classes, meet new professors. It's actually pretty fun, and you should all come to that. 7 to 8:30, HGS 211, I'm hosting. Okay, you should all come. So even if history is not your thing, you should get out there and explore everything that's on offer in these next couple of weeks as this information is being offered to you. And that includes point number four. There are only six in total. Point number four, explore New Haven. Yale can sometimes be a bubble, or to put it less charitably, a fortress, with big iron gates that mark the difference between being inside and being outside. But the city of New Haven is a place that has a lot to teach all of you, and it's a city where your energies can really make a difference. When I was an undergraduate, I worked in New Haven as a GED teacher. I taught writing classes in a women's prison, and I interned at a local newspaper. And though I loved my Yale classes, these other places taught me a great deal as well. Number five, quit things. This was what I did, and it was really great. It was absolutely the right choice. Or at least quit the right things, the ones that aren't truly engaging your energies. And finally, take care of yourself. And I mean this in two ways. The first is the more literal. Yale tends to push people to do more and faster and better, to stay up all night and then brag about how little you've slept and then wake up and sign up for even more. This is actually not a good idea. The bigger challenge here is to find some sort of balance in your life, to make sure that you have time to do things like eat and sleep and read and reflect, and sometimes do nothing at all. So that's one way that I hope that you will all take care of yourselves. But I also hope that during your 4 years here, you'll find a way to take care of yourself. That part of you that is more than the sum total of accomplishments and expectations and who you might appear to be on paper. These next 4 years are a time to explore new ideas and meet remarkable new people and to challenge yourselves in new ways. Part of this means figuring out who you are and who you want to be and what you want to contribute to the world. Your 4 years at Yale, starting tomorrow, are a chance to throw out the old script and to write your own story of your own life. Thank you.
This is a place, as you're writing your own life, this is a place that you will discover has many components to it that claim at least to be timeless. One of these is the song Bright College Years, known also as our alma mater. The Glee Club will help you learn the alma mater. This is a song that, that's your cue to come up. Are you guys coming up on stage? This is very well rehearsed. This is a song that they will help you learn today, and it will also be a song you'll hear numerous times throughout your Yale career, and it will be the last song you sing together in May of 2019. Even though I was not myself an undergraduate here, heard the song quite a bit in my 8 years of living in the college, the song strikes a deep chord with me, and I think it's actually quite true, the lyrics that is. Hopefully it will come to mean as much to you as it does to this guy who didn't even come to this school. Yale Glee Club is going to sing, the lyrics are on the back, by the way. They'll sing the first verse by themselves. They'll repeat that first verse, which you will then join, and read in the second verse. Now, one last piece of advice, or direction. On your seats, I believe you all have, or you're given, this Yale 19 handkerchief. I actually don't know the history behind this one. It's charming. Well, it's weird the first time you see it. Then it becomes charming after a while. In the closing lines, at the end of the second verse, you'll see, for God, for country, and for Yale. You will take this handkerchief in your right, well, I'm left hand, but you know, in the hand, and you will go for God, for country, and for Yale. And you will wonder why, and you will feel awkward, but there are 1,000 other people feeling awkward with you at the same time. It's your first lesson in togetherness. Ladies and gentlemen, the Yale Glee Club. Jeffrey Dauma and the Yale Glee Club. Thank you very much. You are now excused. Wait, don't move. Hannah, where's Hannah? You said you're being the...
Is there an order of exit?
Exit the same way you came in. Enjoy your evening. Have a lovely time at freshman dinner. And have a fabulous time in class tomorrow.